just delivered. I shall now give the floor to the representative of Papua New Guinea, the representative to introduce the statement of the head of government.
Thank you, Vice President. Mr. President, Secretary General, Excellencies and distinguished delegates, it is my pleasure to introduce a pre-recorded video statement to the 75th United Nations General Assembly from the Prime Minister of the Independent State of Papua New Guinea, the Honourable Mr. James Marape, MP. Thank you.
His Excellency, Mr. Volkan Bosky, President of the United Nations General Assembly. His Excellency, Mr. Antonio Guterres, Secretary General of the United Nations. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, on behalf of the government and people of Papua New Guinea, I am pleased to address for the first time this august body in an unprecedented manner via a pre-recorded virtual video. This has emanated courtesy of the COVID-19 pandemic, impacting worldwide and devastatingly on all aspects of our livelihoods. Our sympathies, condolences, and prayers are with the many victims of this virus, and we stand in solidarity with all nations and peoples affected by it. Mr. President, I congratulate you and the government of Turkey on your election to lead the important work of the General Assembly over the next year. I pledge Papua New Guinea's support during your tenure under the well-chosen term of strengthened multilateralism that reinforces the collective good of we the peoples of the United Nations as called for by the Charter of the United Nations. And I also want to thank the outgoing President of the General Assembly, His Excellency Mr. Tizani Muhammad Bande, for his outstanding leadership, including over the past 7 months amid the COVID-19 pandemic challenges. Similarly, we thank Secretary General Guterres for his decisive and robust leadership of our collective work. Mr. President, this year we reflect on the 75th anniversary of the United Nations, the importance and necessity of the United Nations, particularly for small nations like mine, cannot be overstated. Though much work, including strengthening reforms of the United Nations, is needed for a better and fairer world for all, it has also made much progress on global peace and security, human rights, and social issues. We have seen this firsthand in my own country in support of our development priorities, including the Transformative Partnership for Sustainable Development to combat COVID-19, measles, polio, and TB, foster peace and security, in particular in Bougainville and in the Highlands region, supporting our women and girls' equality, empowerment and protection from gender-based violence and environmental protection, and combating climate changes. The onus is on all of us as succeeding generations to work collectively through multilateralism under the United Nations to stop the scourge of war, to reaffirm faith in fundamental human rights, to reestablish the basic conditions for justice and the rule of law, and to promote social progress and better standards of life in the future we want. My government also recognized the important role of the United Nations system in support of the United Nations member state development priorities. In this context, I want to place on record my government's appreciation to the United Nations Deputy Secretary General, Her Excellency Ms. Amina Mohammed, for being the first ever female and the highest ranking officer to visit Papua New Guinea in the past 45 years of partnership between Papua New Guinea and the United Nations. This was indeed a landmark UN visit and most welcome by my government to further consolidate the strong, cordial, expanding and constructive bonds that exist between Papua New Guinea and the United Nations. Mr. President, COVID-19 continues to test our resolve as countries and peoples like never before with its multifaceted impacts. To protect my country and my people, my government took leadership and ownership to set in place the necessary early preventative measures in policies and law, including passage of the National Pandemic Act 2020, to deal with it and such similar outbreaks into the future. This has cushioned, to some extent, the loss of lives to just six so far in my country. We are also working closely at the Pacific regional level through the Pacific Islands Forum to tackle COVID-19, and this has been relatively successful with minimal loss of lives. The net effect of COVID-19 has resulted in job losses, export and other revenue declines, and development priorities put on hold, as I outlined last July in our first voluntary NESA review report on the implementation of our 2030 Agenda on Sustainable Development to the High-Level Political Forum. Unless and until effective vaccine is developed and available for use, the health threats of COVID-19 cannot be underestimated. It is important that any COVID-19 vaccine developed should be for public health good and accessible and affordable to everyone. Mr. President, my government is firmly committed and determined not to let COVID-19 overwhelm us. It is in this spirit that my government's Take Back Papua New Guinea vision is framed to build back better, be resilient, be greener, and take us forward as we strive towards achieving our long-term vision 2050. To build back better from COVID-19, my government has adopted a five-pronged strategic approach. The first response will be Papua New Guinea-owned, led, and driven, which includes a vision for the future, using this crisis as a way to reshape our society into one that is fairer, united, and more inclusive. Secondly, the response will be broad, comprehensive, and inclusive, covering households in both rural and urban areas, and also businesses, both small and big, formal and informal. Thirdly, it will be smart and forward-looking, where focus is on practical projects that build our economic capacity, with public investment programs focused on projects ready to go and procurement arrangements streamlined to allow early commencements of activities. Fourth, we want response to be responsible. This means managing our debts in a way that it does not further burden the country in the medium to long term. Fifthly, leveraging appropriate development partnership. In this regard, we also welcome with interest the financing for development initiative spearheaded by Canada, Jamaica, and the United Nations Secretary General. Mr. President, we have reopened the economy for business to resume operations and invested in an economic stimulus package valued at 5.6 billion kina or US $1.6 billion, by far the largest in our nation's history, to support our local small to medium enterprises, including particularly small farmers in the rural areas and women entrepreneurs, aimed at also strengthening food security and livelihoods. This was done with support of our development partners in country, such as national banks, superannuation funds, and state-owned enterprises, and also from IMF, World Bank, and the Asian Development Bank, as well as bilateral partners, including Australia and Japan. We are grateful to our development partners for their continued support. Mr. President, most recently, my government has passed legislative amendments to our resource laws to address imbalances in major resource development projects. These amendments were to the Oil and Gas Act 1998 and the proposed 2020 Organic Law on Hydrocarbon and the Mining Act 1992. By doing that, we can now negotiate fair and equitable returns for all stakeholders, including multinational companies, from the exploitation of renewable and non-renewable resources. Despite the reforms, I place on record that Papua New Guinea is still an attractive investment destination. And I invite foreign direct investments in all sectors, including hydrocarbon, mining, energy, agriculture, fisheries, forestry, and tourism. Mr. President, in terms of good governance, I am pleased to inform that Papua New Guinea continues to meet its obligation as a member state party to the United Nations Convention Against Corruption. It is also anticipated that the Organic Law on our Independent Commission Against Corruption will be passed in this term of Parliament. The draft Organic Law has been debated in Parliament, and an interim office of ICAC is being operated and is being funded by government. In addition to that, a separate Whistleblowers Act has been unanimously passed by the current Parliament to protect and encourage reporting on corruption. Simultaneously, reforms to the judiciary for a separate track on corruption-related offence for speedy proceedings have also been undertaken. My government, through its recently launched Connect PNG Policy 2020 to 2040, is aimed at building and rehabilitating and expanding key enabling high-quality economic infrastructure such as roads, airports, and seaports. These are critical enablers to create economic corridors to connect our provinces and provide our micro, small, and medium enterprises access to good markets and export opportunities. Mr. President, my government is now rolling out an extensive rural electrification program to light up 70% of the country, which has been without reliable and affordable electricity by 2025, when we celebrate 50 years of independence. Mr. President, my country recognized the importance of ICT and the recently completed construction of a domestic fiber optic submarine cable nationwide and the launching of the International Coral Sea cable linking our country with Australia and Solomon Islands and the rest of the world. This will enable Papua New Guinea to access reliable and affordable high-speed internet aimed at improving connectivity to all sectors, building e-commerce channels, and enhanced government online services. Mr. President, also as a maritime nation, my government is placing high priority on an investment and protection of our fisheries and marine sector. This sector contributes a quarter of our annual budget and also employs 80% women workforce in our tuna canneries. In support of this sector, we launched in July 2020 our first ever National Oceans Policy 2020 to 2030, which will ensure that our oceans and seas and the resources are properly coordinated, managed, protected, governed, and sustainably used. This will also contribute to further strengthening our national efforts to implement our SDG 14 commitments and obligations. It will also support the August 19 decision of the Pacific Islands Forum leaders under the Blue Pacific Continent Narrative to ensure that our maritime zones delineated in accordance with the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea could not be challenged or reduced as a result of high sea level rise and climate change. We therefore look forward with keen interest to the outcome of the International Law Commission Study Group on sea level rise in relation to international laws. We are also interested to harnessing regional and global efforts, including second United Nations Ocean Conference in 2021 and the launch of the United Nations Decade of Ocean Science next year, and for the successful conclusion of the BBNJ Treaty negotiations to further protect our maritime zones, the natural resources, and the sustainable use of them. Mr. President, as we embark on the Decade of Action to deliver on the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, I reaffirm my government's commitment to this important universal agenda. A voluntary national review report to the high-level political forum last July, which I presented virtually, clearly outlines and articulates the status of our national SDGs and its implementation, the gaps and challenges. The unexpected COVID-19 challenges will compound and undermine many of our development gains. Notwithstanding this, my government is taking leadership and ownership of this under our Strategy for Responsible Sustainable Development and the Medium-Term Development Plan number 3, as well as our Development Cooperation Framework. We recognize that governments alone cannot achieve the SDGs. We therefore welcome development and multi-stakeholders partners to join us in delivering on the future we want. Mr. President, under SDG 13, Papua New Guinea continues to comply with the Paris Agreement under the UNFCCC and presented our National Determined Contributions Report to the United Nations, which was reviewed recently. On deforestation and forest degradation, I call upon the United Nations to assist finding a balance between cutting out trees and forests for revenue against preserving them to mitigate the adverse impacts of climate change, given that Papua New Guinea has 13% of the world's rainforest and in that 7% of world's biodiversity. This continues to be an ongoing challenge for my government in terms of meeting the people's basic needs to sustain their livelihoods against preservation of the forest in response to global warming. My government has recently approved PNG's National Read Plus Strategy and its country report, which is prerequisite for accessing the fund. Mr. President, the Bougainville peace process remains a priority of my government, and we are committed to the peace agreement, which has enabled nearly two decades of unbroken peace in Bougainville. I thank United Nations for its continued support to the peace process on Bougainville. A referendum was conducted on Bougainville. The result of the referendum is non-binding, wherein it does not determine a political future, but rather the responsible rest with the National Parliament on a political future for Bougainville. As I speak, the ABG elections are being conducted for a new government by September 2020, and we are confident of a successful election. Mr. President, my government stands ready to welcome newly elected members of the Bougainville House of Representatives and look forward to a cordial working relationship and a fruitful consultative process before a decision by national government on the future of Bougainville. Mr. President, as we commemorate this year the 25th anniversary of the Beijing's Fourth World Women Conference, I would underscore that ensuring gender equality and empowerment cannot be taken for granted. In my country, we have a long way to go yet, but this is work in progress and some level of success has been witnessed thus far. The scourge of gender-based violence is of a serious concern to my government, and we are now not only reviewing its policies and laws to address it effectively, but we are also taking enforcement measures to prevent this unacceptable situation. There is an upswell of support at all levels, both in government, the private sector, and the civil society, to stamp out gender-based violence in my country. An important recent development was the launch of the Spotlight Initiative in March 2020, a joint initiative between my government and the European Union and the United Nations. This is a long-term priority requiring sustainability and partnerships, as the government cannot achieve this alone. Another important development my government is pursuing is to increase the level of women's representation in our parliament, which at present does not have a woman parliamentarian. It is incumbent on us to ensure that half of our country's population, constituting women and girls, have voice in the highest political level, and it is the right thing to do so. Mr. President, finally, we reiterate our call once again for the necessity and urgency and the holistic reforms of the United Nations, particularly the Security Council, whose binding mandate on global peace and security with practices that are inconsistent with today's realities necessitates the reforms must take place to make it more transparent and accountable to the wider United Nations membership. Mr. President, in closing, and speaking of United Nations reforms, Papua New Guinea welcomes the long overdue establishment of the United Nations Multi-Country Office for the North Pacific region and looks forward to its opening and operations soon to support sustainable development efforts of our Pacific sisters and brothers from the Micronesian sub-region. Thank you very much. God bless.
On behalf of the General Assembly, I should now like to thank the Prime Minister of the Independent State of Papua New Guinea for the statement which he has just delivered. I shall now give the floor to the representative of Eswatini to introduce the statement to be delivered by the